An international human rights organization has recognized the Philippine-based Rights Alliance for its commitment to promoting human rights in the Philippines. Human Rights First, based in New York and Washington, D.C., recently presented Karapatan Alliance for the Advancement of People's Rights, the William Zabel Human Rights Award, which is given annually to individuals and organizations across the globe to acknowledge their courage and struggle for freedom and human rights. To talk to us more about this, we have with us this morning Karapatan Secretary General Cristina Palabay in Manila, and in London, Brian Dooley, Senior Advisor of Human Rights First. Good morning, Tinay and Brian. Welcome to the program.
Thanks very much.
Morning.
Brian, I know it's rather late where you are in London. Let me begin with about the award. Tell us a bit more about the award. Why, out of the hundreds of organizations around the world, why Karapatan?
Well, we've been giving this award to human rights defenders around the world for over 30 years now. And, you know, what Karapatan is doing is pretty astounding. You know, we know that it's one of the most dangerous places in the world for human rights defenders to work. We've given this award before to defenders who've been working in China, in Syria, in Mexico. But certainly the work that Karapatan does is very valuable and very dangerous. You know, I'll let Tina speak more about the work that they do, but when you look at the statistics, you know, 15, I think, of their members have been killed over the last 5 years. And they've taken on a new burden really during this age of COVID, when, you know, they've been doing much more, I guess, frontline work, if we could call it that, working with community pantries and so on. So I've known the organization for many years. Tina and I met some US members of Congress a few years ago. We did a little advocacy tour in Washington, DC. And they're just, you know, a fantastic organization that's doing brilliant work in the most difficult circumstances. You know, their members are routinely vilified and red tagged and threatened. And as we've seen, actually killed.
Tinay, congratulations on the award. How significant is this award to your organization at this time? We note that, as Brian mentioned, in the past 5 years, 15 of your members have been killed, nearly 70 since 2001. But beyond the numbers, what is the cost of fighting for human rights in the Philippines?
Well, thank you, Mike. Thank you, Brian. Actually, it is our honor to receive this kind of solidarity from an NGO, from an organization that is based in the US. I mean, this award means a lot to us because of the precisely of the context, what Brian said, the context that we live in, on how dangerous is it for our human rights workers, especially on the ground, to traverse through the landscape, the difficult landscape today, you know, where human rights defenders have targets on their backs because of the red tagging, because of the judicial harassment that we all experience. Many of our regional leaders were arrested the past year since the pandemic, due to trumped up charges. And this is the reason why we ask for legal protection from the Supreme Court. Unfortunately, that legal protection has not yet been granted since 2019, and many of our human rights workers have been killed since then. And we fear that the ongoing, the onslaught of these attacks against defenders and our communities would continue as long as we have this kind of governance, which adopts a kill approach, not only against human rights defenders, but practically anyone during these times.
Brian, I wonder if the choice of Karapatan is an indication of how your organization views the situation in the Philippines. In your view, what has changed throughout the years and what are areas of concern?
Well, yes is the short answer. I mean, you know, the context in the Philippines is very severe and getting worse, it would seem, in the last few years. Now, it's not like, you know, it used to be fine and suddenly it isn't. I mean, it's always been very challenging, of course, for human rights workers like those with Karapatan. But certainly there seems to be an intensification over the last few years. And, you know, what local human rights defenders like TNA and others are asking for from other organizations like ours is shows of solidarity by giving this award. This is really a gesture. One thing I think with substance that we're doing is that we're working now with Carapitan on, we've developed some new technology to try to track the hate speech and the threats and the death threats that Tina and some of her colleagues at Carapitan sadly routinely face. And so we hope at Human Rights First that by developing this tech with them, it's in early stages yet, but they we will try to offer them some layer of protection beyond the visibility that the award and that the connection with us. And we're hoping to be able to open some doors to American government officials and members of Congress, also to Carapitan. That's one of the things that we can offer.
Brian, if I could get a bit more of a description about that technology you're developing, how exactly will that protect human rights defenders?
Sure. Well, what it will do is, it's an early stage now. We've already started. It started to track the threats made against Carapitan on social media, primarily Twitter, but also elsewhere. So we can follow the accounts who are threatening them. It picks up keywords. There's a lot of machine learning in it. And we hope also to be able to warn somebody who's threatened via Twitter or one of the other platforms, maybe before they even see it themselves. So we'll send them an alert, you know, that our technology has picked up something which looks threatening to us, and you may want to take some action immediately to it. We're also going to be able to trace over time the sorts of threats, where they're coming from, who they're directed at, because we've seen time and again, not just in the Philippines, but in other countries too, that there's this atmosphere, this context of vulnerability whipped up around human rights defenders. You know, it might seem innocent, some name calling on social media, but it can escalate really into something very serious. I mean, the evidence is there with Carapitan. It's not just about people being abusive on social media, wrong though that is. You know, they end up with their members being attacked and murdered.
From your standpoint, Brian, having observed this from a distance, what do you make of recent statements from the Department of Justice and even from the Philippine National Police about opening up drug war review records for a drug war review? Is this enough to say that the Philippines is willing and able to prosecute abuses so as to preclude any investigation? I note that ICC prosecutor Fatou Binsoda is stepping down soon, but no developments yet from the ICC.
Well, look, if a government says they're willing and able to do something, that's welcome, but that's really not enough. Just because they're able to do it and they say they want to do it, isn't enough evidence really to show that they really mean it. Until we start seeing some real hard convictions and prosecutions, one of the drivers across the world of the killing of human rights defenders, including in the Philippines, is impunity. You know, when murderers get away with this, it fuels more murders. And so it's fine to say that, you know, records are being opened and the government is willing to do these things, but really the proof will be in whether or not people who are responsible for the killings are brought to account.
Tina, I do want to get your thoughts about the drug war review, but also recent events, right? The blast in Masbate involving two individuals over which the CPPNP has actually claimed responsibility for. I know that you monitor peace talks between the Philippine government and CPPNP-NDF. So what do you make about calls for accountability, and should the CPPNPA surrender those who are responsible for their deaths?
Mm-hmm. Well, Mike, on the drug war review, I believe Brian said it in terms of the proof in the pudding, no? That accountability in terms of the because these are thousands of cases, no? And if you only have 58 or 61, then that is certainly just a drop in the bucket. At the same time, we are cautioning, no, the Philippine Department of Justice and many other actors in using this to sort of window dress, no? What is the outcome of the report or the resolution of the ICC, as well as efforts at the UN Human Rights Council. At the same time, yes, we're monitoring the peace process between the NDFP and the Philippine government. And we believe that the recent incident, which resulted to the deaths of two civilians, indeed should be brought to account, no, the perpetrators. It is high time that we talk about the resumption of the peace process, because there are mechanisms to address these alleged violations of international humanitarian law. Both sides have claimed so many victims in the process, no? But most especially affected are the civilians. So this process, through the joint agreement on the Comprehensive Agreement for Respect for Human Rights and International Humanitarian Law, we hope that this can be seriously addressed, perpetrators are held accountable, and the process of justice and indemnification, you know, will happen. Because we do not want another tragic incident like this to happen again.
All right. On that note, thank you so much for joining us, Tinay Palabe of Karapatan, Mr. Brian Dooley of Human Rights First.
Thank you very much.